All right, first, in regard to total depravity, once you come to faith in Jesus Christ, do we stay totally depraved, or are we progressively or positionally sanctified at salvation, but not practically? So in essence, once we come to faith in Christ, do we stay totally depraved? Is that an appropriate way to describe the Christian? Not you, of course, personally, but in theory.
I have heard it said that in certain Presbyterian circles, in ordination exams, this question is asked. So obviously, it's a very learned question. I understood it was sort of a trick question. I'll speak first as the not quite humble historian, and then we'll allow the real systematician to speak. It seems to me that once we are regenerated by the Spirit of God, we are no longer totally depraved. Because totally depraved means that we have no understanding with our minds, that we have no freedom of the will to act for God. And so the regenerating work of the Holy Spirit renders the Christian as one who is a new creature in a new creation, and therefore not totally depraved, not totally sanctified, to be sure, in the sense of perfect, but now with new faculties to, as the canons of Dort rightly say, to live for Christ in a whole new way. Was there a second part of that? Positionally sanctified. Sinclair can talk about that. I have questions about that, but certainly beginning the process of progressive sanctification.
Okay.
Good.
You don't want to add anything?
No.
Do you want to take anything away?
Yeah, do you want to take anything away? That's the important question, yeah.
Well, we're being progressively undepraved, aren't we? That's what sanctification is. As the Westminster Confession says, sanctification takes place throughout the whole man. So that just as total depravity, the total there, as Dr. Godfrey said, Dr. Godfrey Magnificus, I should say, said, it doesn't mean that we have reached the nadir of our depravity. We can get worse. It means that there is no part of us that is not wholly tainted by sin. And so when we are regenerate, there is actually no part of us that is untouched by that renewal. And that's one of the reasons why you might say, well, surely that's just something that takes place in the soul. It doesn't touch our bodies. But the New Testament knows nothing about a sanctification that doesn't actually affect the way we use our bodies. Romans 12, 1 and 2, I think, underlines that we give everything to the Lord Jesus Christ. And so we are progressively being totally sanctified, but we are not yet finally sanctified. Good. Which I think is a better way of putting it. To be honest, I'm kind of allergic to this expression, positional sanctification. You know, there's either sanctification or there's not sanctification. Positional kind of conveys to me, it may not convey this to everybody, you know, the context from which we come sometimes determines how we hear things. But to me, it kind of suggests we're positionally sanctified, but we're not actually sanctified. And I would say the New Testament knows nothing about a positional sanctification that isn't actual sanctification. We are actually sanctified. And that is, to go back to the confession of faith, which is bound up with the Trinity hymnal, that's the emphasis of the Westminster Confession. It's a real sanctification throughout in the whole man.
Maybe as a follow-up to that, we sometimes talk about definitive sanctification. How would that be different than positional, as you've described it?
Bob would speak to this. I think often people mean by positional sanctification what you and I would mean by definitive sanctification. That is, there is a radical regeneration takes place in our lives so that, to use Paul's language in Romans 5 and Romans 6, sin no longer reigns. We have died to the dominion of sin, and we've been raised to newness of life. What I think the expression definitive sanctification, which I believe historically was a coinage of Professor John Murray. I don't think that particular expression is used before Murray. What the betterment of that expression is that it doesn't compromise the reality of the sanctification. And I think the language of positional sanctification has often been used in theological contexts in which there is a gap between the positional and the actual. I'm positionally sanctified, but I'm not actually sanctified. And, you know, I think we want to emphasize on basis of Scripture that we are actually sanctified. It's a reality. And it's a radical reality. We are not finally sanctified, but we are really sanctified.
And maybe in since we're on the topic of sort of sanctification and grace, questions often come about in grace we are justified. How is it that we are sanctified by grace as well as justified by
grace? He is much more sanctified by grace than I am, so he should answer that one. Tell us about somebody in church history who was sanctified.
Have you heard of Reverend MacDonald of... we were talking about this in the car. It's an in-joke. Sinclair has an obscure Scottish minister from an obscure Scottish town for every occasion. And it's always very...
That's only the Californian perspective.
I think that's a great question. I'd love to hear Sinclair answer it. To begin with, we're sanctified by grace truly. Grace really is at work in Christians so that we are not only not as bad as we could be, but not as bad as we once were, that there is real progress in grace. It seems to me the Reform point of view also is that by and large we're sanctified slowly. We do not make as much progress as we'd like to. I always come back to the statement in the Heidelberg Catechism, question 114, after the discussion of the preaching of the law and why will God have the law preached so specifically. And part of the answer is because in this life, even the holiest of men have only small beginnings of that obedience to which we're called. I think that's right. Against the standard of God's holiness, even the holiest of Christians are only just beginning towards the sanctification to which we're really called. And so that should be humbling, but it shouldn't be discouraging. We need to be pursuing sanctification by the grace of God. Now say something intelligent.
That's good.
There definitely seems to be in our day a perspective on grace that's popular that sort of says, we all make small beginnings and so relax. And the pursuit of holiness in light of grace seems to have slipped into the distant background. Can you comment on the aggressive pursuit of holiness?
The answer to that is actually to start reading the New Testament, isn't it? That Jesus' command to his disciples is, be perfect as my heavenly Father is perfect, as your heavenly Father is perfect. And no matter how you fine-tune the nuance of that perfection, you might say, well, he didn't mean be absolutely perfect, he meant be mature. No matter how you might dilute it by these nuances, he really is issuing an exhortation that we should be wholly obedient to his word. And so you get this theme repeated, for example, in Titus, the grace of God has appeared to teach us to renounce ungodly lusts. And so grace, the grace of God in Christ, is intended to produce a vigorous opposition to and resistance to the remainders of indwelling sin in my life. And here I think is the key point. the lavishness of grace is the ground for the most rigorous commands to be holy and to think of it in the reverse order, that the lavishness of grace means that I don't need to be rigorous in the pursuit of holiness. A is a false logic, B is a poor theology, and C is contradicted by plain text of Scripture. And so it's people saying, oh, God is gracious, and then extrapolating from that to their own theological thinking, instead of keeping their noses down in the Scriptures and listening to the way the Scriptures relate together the wonder of God's grace with the vigor and rigor of our obedience to the Word of God.
Yeah, I think we have a wonderful ability to take truths and then use them almost in the opposite direction of what God gave mm-hmm. us the truth mm-hmm. for. And, you know, today I think some people say, well, you know, we make such small beginnings in grace that just relax, you can't do very much and God doesn't really care. And on the other hand, you have people saying, well, he's given you lots and lots of grace, you've made a lot of progress, and then we respond to that by saying, so I don't really have to work very hard anymore because I've already made all this progress. I mean, either way, you really have perverted the situation. And I think what the Scriptures are saying to us, we haven't made very much progress, but we need to work at making more by the grace of God.
I'm just breathing out.
Okay. You may breathe.
Not fire and slaughter, but breath.
Okay, here's a historical question. Were all the reformers in agreement on the doctrines of grace? And since we have a historian in our midst.
No.
All right, next question.
Okay.
Can you give us some examples of where they were not perhaps in agreement? Is there an obscure Scot who was not in agreement?
There are no obscure Scots at the time of the Reformation. They're all perfectly visible.
Well, I think all of the major reformers, well, maybe we should name some. Certainly Luther.
Can you remember any of them?
just barely at my age.
Knox. John Knox.
Was he a major reformer?
He was a Scot.
He was a Scot. certainly Luther.
Name a major Californian reformer.
Robert Schuller.
Oh, yeah.
A little slow there, you know.
Did they have crystal cathedrals at the time of the Reformation?
For the Reform, there were no cathedrals at all because we had no bishops. Anyway, never mind. For Luther, for Calvin, for Knox, for Zwingli, for Beza, we'll put Melanchthon in brackets, shall we? They would all have been agreed about total depravity. They would all have been agreed about unconditional election. I can still remember talking to quite a learned Lutheran Reformation scholar who said, well, Luther certainly didn't agree with the Reformed on unconditional election. And I turned him to passages in Luther's Bondage of the Will that he was shocked to find there. And anyway, so Luther is on our side on unconditional election. I think personally they were agreed on irresistible grace. The more distinctive Reformed doctrines vis-a-vis Luther would be limited atonement, and there's some debate about exactly what Calvin thought about that, that we don't perhaps need to get into here, but the really distinctive Reformed doctrine is perseverance of the saints, that you'll all have to come to Sunday school tomorrow to hear about. Is that enough?
Yeah, here's a follow-up question that is related. I've seen a recent writer assert that Calvin maintained that Christ died sufficiently for the whole world and only efficiently for the elect. Would you agree with this distinction? Can you illuminate its meaning?
Well, that statement was first made, as far as I'm aware, you're much more knowledgeable than I, by Peter Lombard in his Sentences, so centuries before Calvin. And Lombard, in his Systematic Theology, was trying to pull together various strands of medieval theology and harmonize them. And knowing that some medieval theologians had taught that Christ died for the elect alone, Lombard's trying to bring things together and say, well, he died sufficiently for the whole world, efficiently for the elect alone. That statement as it stands was agreed to by the Synod of Dort, although then they proceeded to define sufficiently and efficiently, perhaps somewhat differently than some medieval theologians would have done. Are we getting far too weedy here? Calvin does not, in my judgment, address with specificity the question, for whom did Christ die? It doesn't seem to be an interest that a question that interested him greatly. And so you're asking him to answer a question he didn't really, I think, address. Almost all of Calvin's writings, I think, are in the direction and conformable to the doctrine of limited atonement. There are a few sentences in Calvin that are difficult to reconcile to that. But on the whole, I think Calvin's thought is in that direction, but doesn't seem, as I say, to be a question that Calvin specifically addressed.
He does mention that expression, sufficiently for all, efficiently only for the elect, on, I think, two or three occasions I'm familiar with. Probably the easiest one to find is in his discussion on 1 John chapter 2, verse 2, Christ as the propitiation, not only for our sins, but for the sins of the whole world. And in his discussion of that, he says, at this point, people quite often appeal to this formula to handle the answer to the question, in what sense is Christ the propitiation for the sins of the whole world? And if I remember rightly, he says, that formula is fine, but it's not actually the clue to understanding this text.
Right.
And I think he tends to think of 1 John 2:2 in terms of the distinction between the Jews and the rest of humanity. There are Jews and there's the whole world. The way in which whole world or all tends to be used throughout John's gospel. So it seems to me he's saying, you know, that formulation is fine and it may be helpful, but don't appeal to it as the clue to exegeting this particular text of Scripture.
Good.
I'm sure I found that in one of Dr. Godfrey's articles, anyway.
I knew that once.
Okay, what is the purpose of God for the non-elect? How would you understand his purpose in the non-elect? What is the purpose of God for the non-elect, those who are not elect?
Will I start and you finish? I think we need to answer that question at various levels. God makes the sun shine on the righteous and the unrighteous. I think both Bob and I would want to say that there is a kind of love that God manifests to all men, that within that context, the gospel is preached and they receive overtures of grace, that all of those things are true. Ultimately, probably what is in the mind of someone who asks this question is, but what ultimately? And I think the only answer that we have definitively to that is the way in which Paul treats these things in Romans 9 through 11, and especially Romans chapter 9, that in the face of their sinfulness and rebellion, rather than thinking of God as being diminished by their rebellion, he will show the glory of his righteous judgment in the context of their rebellion. And that's something that I think emotionally is difficult to grasp in the present world, because we know people who have not come to trust in Christ. It's sometimes difficult for us to extrapolate forwards and say, how can I be supremely happy in the presence of Christ when I know there are those who are not in the presence of Christ? And I think one can only draw the line from what Paul says there in Romans 9, that it will be clear to us then how great, holy, true, and pure, and patient is the righteous judgment of God. Emotionally, I do not have the capacity to take that in yet, but I think part of the reason for that is that I am impartially sanctified. Are you nodding to my impartial sanctification or to...
That first. No, I think that's right. I think this point you're making about our age in particular having difficulty with these things, because we've become a very sentimental age, and we live in a culture that prides itself in trying not to be judgmental, mm-hmm. and trying not to be divisive. I was teaching a Sunday school class and read from Psalm 58, verse 10, about the coming judgment in which the righteous will bathe their feet in the blood of the wicked. And you can sort of feel the gasp. You know, this is probably not the verse we most meditate on or find the most immediate comfort in. And yet, if you put yourself in the place, perhaps, of those persecuted Christians, let's say in Egypt, who for centuries have resisted against persecution, we might be a little better able to understand some of that sentiment. But it is Romans 9 that, you know, most meditates on that, and I believe that God has given us the revelation of those truths, obviously not to make us feel superior, as you said, so that we might be assured that God is not diminished in judgment or the lostness of the reprobate. But not only that he's not diminished, but he's not defeated. Mm-hmm. You know, I think that's the context in which most of the discussion of reprobation takes place in the scripture. Judas was the son of perdition who went where he was destined to go. And that is, in a roundabout way, a comfort to us, because it does not mean that Jesus was defeated by the unbelief of Judas. And that's important for you and me, because if Jesus was defeated by the unbelief of Judas, then he may be defeated by our tendency not to believe. And Jesus wants to comfort us and assure us that he is not defeated, and that he will preserve and protect his own. And so that's part of why I think this revelation is actually important for us, not just as a bit of knowledge, but as a real measure of comfort.
You know, Reformed theologians have differed from one another in terms of the basic perspective, you know, the kind of the ultimate circumference beyond which we may not go in thinking theologically. And personally, I think increasingly have felt that the all of this scriptural teaching is given to us within the context of the fall, that these ideas are not abstract ideas, and that actually my problem in wrestling with these questions is the very problem that Anselm, the medieval theologian, pinpointed as his sparring partner Bozo's problem. You have not yet considered the greatness of the weight of sin. And for example, in objections to Reformed theology, and this, I don't think this is meant as an objection, but sometimes this is an objection to Reformed theology, I find myself coming back again and again to that statement of Anselm. This question is being asked in hostility to Reformed theology because you have not yet considered the greatness of the weight of sin. And then if you know, a text that has helped me greatly, actually, probably ever since I was in my teens, is the description that's given at the end of Revelation 6 of the consummation of the last days, when great men and generals will run to the hills and call upon the hills to fall upon them. If I can put that in much more emotive terms for us as Americans, we'll rush to the Twin Towers and say, fall on us, in order to hide us from the wrath of the Lamb. And this is so, to me, is so fascinating because we all know the Apostle John as the Apostle of Love, you know. But the Apostle of Love does not make the false step of thinking that the love of Christ means there is no wrath in Christ. And that phrase, the wrath of the Lamb, Thomas Boston.
Was he Scottish?
He was an obscure Scottish minister. Has this appeal to his congregation when he says, oh, to be damned by him who came to save sinners is to be doubly damned. And this picture that the scriptures give to us of, it's the one who bore the wrath of God as the Lamb of God, whose wrath those who refuse the sacrifice of the Lamb of God will actually feel, I think underscores for us, even emotionally, the absolute righteousness of God's justice and judgment in the last day, and that we can rest in that. And you know, as often is said, it's Jesus who, more than anyone else in the New Testament, actually speaks about the final judgment of God and his participation in it. So that to try to pull this down, which sometimes Christian thinks is, well, it's that kind of nasty Paul that gives us all this, is actually to rip Jesus out of the gospel narrative. It is as central as that. So it's really, you know, I think it's a very important question.
Maybe related to that, a question about falling away, the language of falling away in the New Testament, Demas who fell away, the statement even of Jesus that the elect might even be led astray, or in John 15 being cut out of the vine. How do you understand the security of the believer in light of those kinds of passages?
That's a perseverance question.
It's an irresistible grace question. Well, part of it is, I think, the simplest biblical answer is they went out from us because they were not of us. They had all the external, apparent connections to the community. It's like those who on whom the seed of the word fell, and for a time it seems to grow up, but then withers away because it had no real root. It never really belonged. And so it's a serious warning to the covenant community that just because we're part of the community doesn't guarantee our status before God. And it calls us to a measure of self-examination. So how is it with your soul individually? Are you truly converted to God? Do you really believe in Christ? Do you really belong to him? The promises of never falling away belong to those who really belong to Christ. And I think the scripture is quite consistent with that. It's interesting, the sharpest formulation of that is the imprecation, is it Psalm 69? May they be cut out of the book of life. Hmm. But there too, it's the book of the covenant community, those who claim to be part of the covenant are externally part of the covenant, but by all of their actions show that they really don't belong at all, and so may they be cut out. That's how I begin an answer to a question on irresistible grace.
Good.
Have you ever? I ask him a question?
Here's a. Rather than listen to his question, here's, you know, often in people's minds, Hebrews 6, 4 to 6 is the big passage here. And I remember reading a pretty good New Testament scholar saying that there is no clearer description of a Christian than Hebrews 6, 4 to 6. And yet I think the author of Hebrews actually makes clear this can be true of somebody and they not be a Christian at all, because he goes on to say, I'm actually persuaded of better things of you, the things that belong to salvation. And to me, one of the interesting things about that description that's given, you know, you can be enlightened, you can have tasted the powers of the age to come, is what is actually missing there are the very essential elements of being converted, namely repentance from sin and faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. And apparently it is possible to share in these kind of external manifestations of the power of God in the community of God's people, but never oneself to have repented and believed the gospel. Occasionally in the life of the church and in pastoral ministry, you encounter people that you think, there's just something here that makes me just a wee bit uneasy, and I've no idea what it is. And I couldn't ever say, I don't think this person is a Christian. But there's a little niggle, and 3 years later on, you know, your niggle proves to have been more than a niggle. It really, you've just sensed something. And I think that's in Jesus' parable. You know, here is somebody turns up in church tomorrow. They hear the gospel preached, and there's just this explosion of joy. You know, hallelujah, praise God. You know, if you lifted your hands here, they would be lifting their hands. And we would say such joy is the most glorious fruit of the gospel. But Jesus himself is saying, if all there is joy, then that isn't really a true response to the gospel. It is part of a glorious response to the gospel, but on its own, it's not a true response to the gospel. And so I think one always has to look to see whether, you know, what the older writers called a thorough work of grace has been done in our hearts. I think back on my life as a Christian, and I'm grateful for the counsel of the New Testament that this kind of thing does actually happen, because I've seen it happen in such a way that has almost destabilized other Christians. I mean, I think, one of the most memorable instances of this I think I ever encountered was the hall of residence I was in when I was a student. There was a girl in that hall of residence who had pointed more girls to Christ than anyone else in the university. I remember getting my tray at the refectory, sitting down at breakfast one morning. She was sitting just opposite me. She looked up at me and she said, I am no longer a Christian. And I remember the consternation that took place and the sense of destabilizing in these girls who had been pointed to Christ by her. And yet the peculiar thing was, I remember thinking, oh, that's what made me uncomfortable about you. You know, I couldn't have said to somebody, I don't think this girl is really a Christian. So the fact that we've got this instruction doesn't mean that we have divine discernment to be able to come along to somebody and say, I don't think you're really a Christian. That's the mistake some Christians zealously make.
So your answer raised two questions in my mind. What does it mean to be blinkered? And what is a niggle?
A niggle. Yeah. Well, a blinkered is, you know, You know nothing about horse racing. Are you not a gambling man? Blinkers are what horses you sometimes see in horse races. Now, I've never been to a horse race, but I've seen them on television. And
On the golfing channel?
There are some professional golfers, I think, who probably own race horses.
And some
but
should
they,
be blinkered.
They blinker. Behave yourself. They blinker the horse in order to make the horse focus so that it's not being distracted. So that's what and a niggle. What is a niggle? Do you know what a niggle is?
No, that is but not. A, that is not an American word.
A niggle is
like blood pudding.
No, that's a case of conscience. A niggle
kidding.
Is a little irritation. There's something about you that niggles me. Not you. But, you know, there are people, you know, the people who just have this, they have these little idiosyncratic habits, and it gets on your nerves when you're, you're being niggled. That's a niggle.
Thank you.
You should also know that many are mickle, max a muckle.
Okay.
Can I ask my question?
How about that?
Yeah, sure.
My question is, how much easier would your life as a theologian have been if your theological opponent had been named Bozo? Anselm had a way too good.
I can tell you, it would
advantage
have
over us.
It would have been a lot more fun.
That's right.
You're not supposed to call any of your students you Bozo.
But I have
until
done.
Until they've read Anselm.
That's right.
Okay.
Back on track.
Can someone be of the elect and die without God ever manifesting himself to them down here? So can you be of the elect and yet lack some kind of an experience of faith and repentance?
I answered the last one.
That's clearly an unconditional election question. Well, I would say just personally, and I will wait for the more learned answer. I don't think that can be true of an adult. I think the Lord comes to the elect who reach mature years with the word of the gospel and works in their hearts a response. The question becomes perhaps more focused on the question of infants dying in infancy, and the Westminster Confession says that elect infants dying in infancy are saved, which is true, but tautologically not that comforting. The canons of Dort, once again superior, say the godly parents may believe without doubt that their children dying in infancy are elect and saved, which I think is biblical and true. And exactly how the Lord accomplishes that salvation in the hearts of elect infants, I don't think is clear in Scripture.
Is that where you were going?
There are levels of this question, aren't there? One level of this question is the old question, what of the unevangelized? And it seems to me that in the light of Scripture, the way in which we are encouraged to think about this is not by speculating beyond Scripture, but by the kind of teaching Paul gives in Romans 10, how are they going to believe unless they hear? And how will they hear unless there is a preacher? And how will there be a preacher unless they are sent? And that was one of the great empowering motivations of the missionary movement of the 18th century. And I think we have got to stick with this. We've got to stick within Scripture and understand that this is actually taught to us, and we should seek to advance the gospel on this basis, that unless they hear the gospel preached to them, we cannot anticipate they will be saved. Now, it's within that context, I think, that the Westminster Confession, chapter 10, section 3, has this statement, elect infants dying in infancy are regenerated and saved by Christ, which is tautological because they're was not complete agreement among the Westminster divines as to whether some infants or all infants were saved. And so they have this expression that they can all sign up to. I mean, it's an indication of the fact that the confession is not dotting every I and crossing every T of everything everybody should believe, and also extends it beyond, how does this happen? They're saved by Christ, so they're not saved apart from Christ. They're saved through the Spirit who worketh when and where and how he pleaseth, which Bob is paraphrasing as saying, it's not completely clear in Scripture how this is so. But we know, for example, the picture Luke gives us of John the Baptist leaping in the womb of his mother, the sense that there is a prevenient work of God that can take place even in the womb, the fact that, you know, probably some of us in the room have never known a day in our lives since we were conscious of anything that we were not conscious of trusting in the Lord Jesus. And if you said, well, how were you brought to that faith in Christ? Actually, you've got no historical answer. You know, I was just conscious he was present in our home and family, and I trusted him. And then it goes on to say, so also are all other elect persons who are incapable of being outwardly called by the ministry of the word. And I'm sure that means not who are geographically incapable, but who are constitutionally. I mean, this is speaking to a world where not only probably do the majority of infants die in infancy. So this is a huge question. But this is, you know, to put it this way, this is speaking to a world where the village idiot is actually visible in the village, where those who have been brain damaged, if they survive, which very few would have done, when those who are mentally deranged are not sided off from society, but they're walking around the town, as in my childhood they were in Scotland. And it's saying the tragedy of the effects of human sin on human biology is not an obstacle to the sovereign working of God.
So a related question, words like repent, be baptized, come into the kingdom are all active. So how is it that we can have nothing to do with our salvation?
Well, it's important to recognize that be baptized actually is not active, but passive. Now, you may have to agree to be baptized in the context of where the apostles were preaching, but the act of baptism itself is an act that says, I cannot cleanse myself, and so I turn to Christ in faith and hope that he cleanses me. So there are conditions, there are actions, but the question is, where does the motivation for us to be involved in those actions and fulfill those conditions come from? And that's where things become more complicated, but not really at all troublesome to the system of doctrine. Christ does not call us to be passive, and Christ throughout the New Testament shows us that his Spirit works through imperatives that the Spirit lays on our hearts and draws us by his grace to action.
Maybe it's helpful to think that salvation is not only a statement that's made about us. This person is saved. But it's also a reality that works within us, so that the saved person actually begins to be a saved person. And that the gospel deals both with our status before God in justification, and with the ungodliness that is actually present and offensive to God in our life. And that therefore when salvation begins to work in us, as sometimes people say, when I got saved, if you didn't actually get saved, which means loving, trusting the Lord Jesus, turning away from sin, if you didn't actually get saved, then you never got saved. So salvation is not just as, for example, you know, Roman Catholics were always complaining about this at the time of the Reformation, that justification was a legal fiction. And the Reformers' answer to that was, justification is not the whole of the gospel. There is both justification and regeneration in the gospel. And it's because there is regeneration in the gospel that we actually, from the beginning of God's working in our lives, become saved people. And by definition, saved people are people who trust in the Lord Jesus and turn away from sin. So that the two things don't stand in tension with one another. They're actually complementary to one another. And the other thing to say is that both repentance and faith, it's probably easier to say this with respect to faith, faith is a non-contributory activity. It is entirely receptive in its nature. So that faith does not add anything to what Christ has done. But faith, you know, as the older writers used to say, is the empty hand, which is energized by the regenerating work of the Holy Spirit to stretch out to receive all that is for us in Jesus Christ.
Maybe could you comment on, in relation to that, how union with Christ by faith helps us deal with both the dimensions that you mentioned, the status change in justification, the transformation of the gospel in our lives?
Yeah, you know, through our faith union with Christ and the Holy Spirit, we are united to the Christ in whom both our justification and our sanctification are resourced. I think Christians often understand our justification is resourced in Christ and not in ourselves, but then they sometimes think our sanctification is resourced in ourselves and not in Christ. But both are resourced in Christ, because as Calvin says, he says this on a number of occasions, he was given to us for both. And therefore, to imagine there is such a reality as a justification without sanctification, or sanctification that lacks justification, he says, is to rend Christ asunder. Because he was given us for both these ends.
Great.
And that's why, you know, one of the things that Bob was saying earlier on was this Jesus-centeredness. When we think as Christians in a self-centered way, we think of the justification that I've got and the sanctification that I've got. But what the gospel does is point us to the justification and the sanctification that I haven't got, but that through faith, through the Spirit, I find given to me in Jesus Christ.
And I think Calvin teaches us that brilliantly in the third book of the Institutes. So the third book begins with a very short chapter. They'd say in Scotland, a wee little chapter, of just a couple of pages on how the Holy Spirit gives us faith that unites us with Christ. And then he has a long chapter on what faith is, and then he looks at the way in which faith has implications in the life of the Christian, and precisely to answer the Roman Catholics, the first thing he looks at that faith does for the Christian is to sanctify the Christian. There are chapters on sanctification. And then only having talked about how faith leads on to our sanctification, does he then turn to the subject of how faith leads on to our justification, and then he goes on to see how we have faith only because of God's electing purpose, and how faith will lead in the end to our glorification. So it's brilliant both structurally and of course in the content, but very helpful to us as we think about these things and try to avoid a lot of the confusion of our day.
Great. Let's end with one more question, and I think it's a good one in this context to ask, and that is the Arminian gospel another gospel? as Paul would put it in Romans 1?
Well, that's a historical question. So, as a country pastor, I think my answer is, which Arminian are you talking about? We always need to be careful about labeling people. It's a bit like if you watch the Golf Channel. So you can't get the Golf Channel in Scotland, so I always want to be in hotels in the States where you can get the Golf Channel. And you get these analysts of the swing. And, if you watch professional golfers, there are great golfers with very classic swings. And then there are some golfers who, if you saw them warming up on the local golf course, you would think, he probably isn't very good. Like, not to name names, like Jim Furyk, who has a very idiosyncratic swing. So the real issue is not so much what happens on the way back, although there's a classical way of doing it. It's not what happens on the way from there to there. It's actually what happens in the hitting area. And I think, using this metaphor, you can say, there are Arminians who almost completely miss the hitting area. That the way in which their theology formulates the essence of their preaching of the gospel actually distorts the gospel. And there are Arminians who, with all the other funny bits going on that potentially could distort the gospel, when they actually come to how do I present Christ to people? Present Christ to people as the only Savior. The kind of thing in the midst of all the differences between Wesley and Whitfield in the 18th century. When it came to the hitting zone, both would write in their journals, I offered them Christ. So, it depends which Arminian you're talking about, I think. Bob's an expert on Arminius and Arminianisms, because there really are Arminianisms, I think, aren't there?
One question that Steve hasn't gotten to is it possible to pray, lead us not into temptation, and play golf? But I digress. If you think of the spectrum with at one end Augustinianism or Paul's doctrine of irresistible grace, and at the other end Pelagius, who taught that you could be saved without grace at all. So all is of grace, you don't need grace at all. If that's the two extremes, then we have said in the history of the church, some have said in the history of the church, in between those two extremes, everything in between you could call semi-Pelagianism. The problem is semi-Pelagians come, as Arminians come, because they are semi-Pelagians, in very different stripes. So Arminius himself really tried to say almost everything is of grace and wanted to leave just a little bit of space for human freedom. And at the other end, you have semi-Pelagians who really talk very little about grace and focus almost entirely on the freedom of the will. Now, about Arminius himself, who tried very valiantly to talk as much as he could about grace while leaving just a little space, the great English Puritan William Ames was asked, is the Arminianism of Arminius, because Ames was at the Synod of Dort, is the Arminianism of Arminius a heresy? Now, in those days, to call someone a heretic was to say they were not saved. A heretic had so deviated from truth that he could not be saved. And Ames responded, Arminianism is a serious theological error that tends to heresy. And I think that's a helpful thing to say. It is a serious error. It's dangerous in part because of its instability. But we should certainly not want to say, it seems to me, that all Arminians are heretics. But there's a danger of moving in a heretical direction as you move into that semi-Pelagian continuum.
There was a very well-known 19th century Scottish professor of Hebrew who had a quite eccentric golf swing because he was a somewhat eccentric man. He married later in life, and his maiden aunt, I think she was maiden, looked after him. And she said to him on the morning of his wedding, "It's time to go upstairs and get changed, John." And of course, he was so eccentric, that was the last thing she always said to him at night. "It's time to go upstairs and get changed, John." She didn't say, "Get into your PJs." So his wedding morning, she said, "It's time to go upstairs and get changed," meaning get ready for your wedding. And 2 hours later, she goes upstairs because he hasn't come down and he's lying asleep in his PJs. Now, to his students, he read these words, "Long my imprisoned spirit lay, fast bound in sin and nature's night, thine eye diffused a quickening ray. I woke, the dungeon flamed with light. My chains fell off, my heart was free. I rose, went forth, and followed thee." And then he said, "Where is your Arminianism now, friend?" Because, of course, that, my Trinity hymn book says, was written by somebody called Charles Wesley. Which is to say, that when he gets into the hitting zone, which is a golfing metaphor, by the way, Bob, when he gets into the hitting zone there, and actually clearly reflects on his own experience, he does actually get through the hitting zone of the gospel well.
J.I. Packer, a number of years ago, wrote a very helpful essay called Two Arminianisms, where he distinguished evangelical Arminianism of Wesley from the rational Arminianism of the later Remonstrants in the Netherlands, and I think that's right. Are you going to tell us the story about John Wesley's conversation with Charles Simeon?
No, you can tell that one.
You'll tell it better.
No, I just want to make sure you get it right.
I probably won't get it right. That's why I want you to tell it. In any case, Simeon, as a Calvinist, I'll make it brief and vague, talked to Wesley about this issue and basically said to Wesley, "Do you believe we're saved by grace alone?" He said, "Yes." "Do you believe that we contribute anything to our salvation?" "No, I don't." And then I think Simeon said, "Then I don't think the differences between us amount to very much." Is that kind of right?
Kind of.
Yeah. He's mean to me. You've seen that in this.
Well, we need to wrap up our morning. Let's appropriately thank these men for their work with us.